And now I'll ask you to think about special offers. Not the flash tuppence off signs you see on things like toothpaste packs. No, the sort I mean are the special offers you see plastered on shop fronts which try to entice you into the shops. Are they really a good buy? I went down to Camden Town and asked, do you think special offers really are cheaper?
I think so. I wondered if they took it off one thing and put it on another. I had my doubts there.
I haven't seen anything special anywhere for years.
I think sometimes they're quite genuine. You know, they're really a bargain.
Did you buy any of the special offers they've got advertised in the window?
No.
Did you notice them when you came in?
No, I didn't bother. I went straight in. I wanted.
When you went into the store, did you go looking for some of the special offers that they've got advertised in the window?
No, not really. We went looking for a general shopping list.
It didn't affect
you? Usual weekend shopping list. We checked them, obviously, and we buy the things that, if we see them and we want them and no special offer, so much the better.
Did you have any other special offers that they've been advertising in the window?
No. I don't know.
Well, quite a difference of opinion there, but now with our guest in the studio, we ask, are special offers a good idea or are they confusing? Why do some shops use them and some shops don't? And are they really cheaper? Well, with me now is Sandra Brooks, chairman of the National Housewives Association, Janet Upwood of the National Federation of Consumer Groups, Mike Reynolds, managing director of Spar Vivo, Ian McLaurin, Managing Director of Tesco, and Charles Hawes, Director of Waitrose. Now, I'd like to start off, first of all, by asking all three of you, in turn, how you stand when promotions are concerned. First of all, Mr. Hawes, what is your attitude towards promotions in store?
Well, we have promotions like anybody else does. I think that there are as many ways of retailing as there are fleas on a sheepdog. We choose different ways because we're different kinds of retailers. We try and identify our market and we go for those particular consumers. My own company for many years has tried to offer a broad assortment at keen prices right across the assortment.
But I understood that you'd phased out promotions recently completely.
No, not completely. No, no. Right. We've played them down, yes. Right. We haven't phased them out.
Mr. Reynolds.
Well, we run promotions because we think it's necessary to have something like 8 or 10 important products at well below the normal market prices. We don't think that this is enough. We think we ought to run some competitions and some sorts of promotions that are loyalty builders, that makes shopping a little bit of fun, that makes people want to come and shop with us. And we find that these work very effectively in terms of keeping our customers happy.
Thank you. And Mr. McLaurin?
Well, at Tesco, we purchase for about 12 million customers a week. This is a vast shopping basket. We pitch our prices totally to be as competitive as we possibly can. But because we are buying for so many people through so many stores, we are able to negotiate with manufacturers even better deals on food and on home and wear lines, so that every fortnight we are able to give the customers extra special value on probably 30 lines.
All right, thank you very much. Now, I know that several people feel confused by all these promotions. Can I go first to Sandra Brooks to get a reaction from... Sorry, no, I'm going to go to Janet Upwood first. Sorry, Sandra. What's your reaction to that? Do you like promotions?
Well, I can sympathise with the view that shoppers are confused in the present situation in the marketplace. But I think they're confused for a whole variety of reasons. The rapid rise in the rate of inflation, confusing packaging, standard packs you mentioned earlier in the programme, the lack of objective information. We've already heard that the retailers regard special offers as a way of getting people into the store. From the consumer's point of view, I believe that special offers can be of benefit to them. They are bargains, but we've got to keep our head. We've got to be provided with the right sort of information which enables us to judge the real value of the special bargains. And we've got to learn to play the game as effectively as we can. I don't think the answer is to rush around and throw our hands up and say we must go back to one price across the whole range of things. I think there has got to be a variety of prices and that special bargains can be very valuable to the consumer.
What about Sandra Brooks? I'm not sure that you would entirely endorse those views.
No, I wouldn't endorse them at all. Listening to the three gentlemen on the other side, I'm beginning to wonder if they're in the selling business or the entertainment business. Simply because I heard, I think it was Mr. McLaurin saying, he's able to negotiate at periods various good bargains for housewives. Now, I'm after stability for housewives, and I thought the whole name of the game at the moment was to try and get stability in the country. So I'm sure in the shopping field, that's what women want.
Yes,
stability all the time.
Yes, I think you're probably quite right. Every retailer wants some form of stability. We are living in highly inflationary times, and it is very difficult for the average housewife to appreciate the prices and how they're going. My advice to them is, look at the windows, see what the special offers are. Shirley Williams, in fact, has asked us to have in our promotions, week by week, lines that the housewife wants. And in fact, she or her department has produced a list asking us to do so. And I think the majority of large retail chains are doing just this.
Mr. McLaurin, if you say you are giving the housewife a fair deal, why is it necessary for some weeks for you to be fairer than other weeks?
Well, I don't think that's really a true statement. We promote 30 lines per week, per fortnight. Now, if the housewife wants to take advantage of those lines, we're able to pass on extra savings to her. We're not saying to her, Mrs. Housewife, come in, you've got to buy these lines. We're saying that they're there. And we like to be able to do this to give them better value. If we can give better value, that's what the game's all about.
I would support that view. My fear is, I mean, obviously we don't want special offers that are subsidised out of higher prices all round, and I think possibly this is what the fear behind what Sandra is saying. But certainly, it certainly makes sense to me to concentrate bargains on a number of things. In other words, to concentrate your jam rather than spread it too thinly. And the danger, in my view, trying to spread it too thinly, is that we shall end up with the situation of recommended resale price maintenance again, and we shall all be worse off.
I was going to say, I agree very much with what Sandra said. I do think stability at the moment is of tremendous importance. But nevertheless, we must recognise that even though at Spar Vivo we ran a period where we had a price freeze on about 40 very important lines in our own label range, we still gave special offers which were able to buy at discounted prices from the manufacturer of their particular lines during that period of time. But the one thing that we ought to be trying to aim at is that the housewife, who's only got a limited amount of money available in her purse, knows roughly what that amount of money will buy this week and preferably next week. But with an inflation rate of over 25%, it's pretty tough going for us all.
But you see, the whole point of special offers means that the housewife doesn't, unless she's a whiz kid and a mathematician to boot, she's not going to know when, unless she shops in the same way all the time, when your special offers are going to be on.
Well, you're being very unfair to housewives. In my experience, most of them are very conscious of what is good value and what isn't.
Mr. Hawes, can I ask you just to enlarge on why you decided to phase out promotions in your store?
Well, we didn't decide to phase out promotions. As a matter of policy, my company has always offered keen prices right across the board. What we do, because we think it appeals to our kind of customer, is to retail in a certain way. And that way consists of not beating the drum, if you like. Our shops, we hope, are uncluttered, clean, hygienic. We believe our customers, our particular customers, like them that way.
You think you confuse them less?
I don't think people are as confused
as
some people.
They are terribly confused.
I don't think they are.
I think it's very important to realise that none of us, as fairly important retailers, want to confuse our customers. I think you used the phrase, Sandra, that on our side, we're both on the same side. We're both anxious to get food to the housewife in as efficient a way as we possibly can, at the lowest possible price, and to make a modest profit in the process of doing it. Unless we make that profit, we won't stay in business, and the housewife won't be able to buy food at all. We don't want to go back to that situation.
Sandra, I think where you probably slightly misunderstand the total picture, manufacturers have a promotion budget, which they spend on advertising, on television, what have you. Now, if they're putting a large campaign together on television, they will come to Tesco and say, we would like you to back this in your store with a special promotion. If we're able to come to terms on volume, we'll back that promotion and the housewife will get the benefit in the end. And I don't believe that the housewives of this country are so confused as you say they are. I think they're pretty shrewd people.
Can I just come in and go back to a point that was raised earlier, and one of our shoppers raised on the film? What is the feeling of you big retailers about this public fear that because there's tuppence off something, that tuppence has been put on somewhere else?
Totally untrue, because I can understand the fear, but it's a good opportunity really to put the kibosh on it once and for all.
None of us
customers will not come into our store unless they're satisfied. They don't have to come to Tesco or Waitrose or anybody. They select the store they go to. If they feel they're not getting a square deal, then they won't come back to you. Our job, we're in business through the customer. If we don't satisfy that customer, she won't come back to us, and then we're out of business, and we can't afford that.
None of us would dare do it, and apart from anything else, under the recent legislation, it would be against the law, because we're not allowed to reprice goods upward, and therefore, it would be absolutely impossible for any of us to think of doing it. You've got to remember, we're all in very, very close competition with each other. We, in Spar Vivo, trying to keep our customers shopping near to their homes. Mm. Ian, trying to get them to come into the big high street supermarket.
Mr. Reynolds, I'd like to break in there and ask you a question directly about whether or not it wouldn't be better to actually, instead of get these sort of single promotions and banners and streamers type shopping, to distribute lower prices all round in your shops instead of going for specific promotions with all the money that you probably pay in advertising your promotions. In other words, just bring down all the prices relatively.
If we stopped advertising completely, I doubt whether we'd be able to take more than a halfpenny off a line. Really, it amounts, the total advertising budget, which largely, as Ian has said earlier on, comes from manufacturers, the total budget would not be able to affect our pricing policy in any way at all.
Mr. Hawes, do you agree with that?
I can't speak. We don't advertise. We don't know very much about advertising because we've never done it.
But you do
we find we do our business without advertising.
Yes, but you do your own brand, so therefore you in fact reduce most of your products rather than a few in your own way.
I don't think our proportion of own brand is that much higher than the proportions that our competitors carry. We try and level our prices over the whole of our range, and it is a pretty wide range. A good deal wider, I think,
yes,
than most other people.
You can't expect all retailers to follow the same pattern of retailing. And what is suitable for one company, aiming at one particular segment, is difficult for another company. And I really do feel that in the present situation, if some shops wish to offer special offers as part of their selling techniques, that's fine. All I'm saying is that housewives have got to keep their heads. The shops have got to make it crystal clear what price actually they are charging, and by and large they do. Then it's up to the housewives to decide whether they're bargains or not.
As the leaders of our country aren't really keeping their heads, I don't see how you can expect housewives to keep their heads. But really, my argument is that the whole game is far too sophisticated. We're being confused with a jumble of banners and advertising gimmicks, and we're all sick and fed up with it.
Well, on that note, where everybody, at least one of our guests, is sick and fed up with it, we're going to have to leave the thing. We'll be back next Friday at the same time, 2 o'clock, when we should be talking about prices, amongst other things. See you then.